Tool changes have been out of reach for most hobbyists over the last decade. Dropping a couple of $1,000s on something like the E3D tool changer or the Prusa XL is hard to justify when you could buy, say, a P1P with an AMS for far less. This option though, pushing materials through a single nozzle, the so-called multiplexing as we know from Prusa's MMU or later from Bamboo Lab's AMS approach, is cheaper up front but costs you a lot of time and filament in the long run. The Snapmaker U1 aims to change both sides of that equation. High-speed tool changing without the high price and without that waste. At under $1,000, even way less for Kickstarter backers, you are promised to get 4 tool heads, modern print speeds, and convenient automated material feeding. So what's the catch here? Let's take a deep first look and talk about whether it's worth the Kickstarter gamble. Just to be clear, this is a preview of a late-stage prototype. This is not the final product. The full review will come later this year. This video is sponsored by Snapmaker, but I had full creative control. Snapmaker hasn't seen this video before you, and if something's bad, you'll hear it. That was the most important reason I agreed to do this. Kudos to Snapmaker for that, they seem very confident in their product. Anyway, there's still homework to do for Snapmaker and their U1 tool changer. Let's elaborate the good, the bad, and what needs to improve before it gets sent out to customers. This is a late-stage pre-production prototype, but the packaging and unboxing already feel close to what backers will get, with some small changes possible. So I'll just give you the short version here and save this for the final review. You get a clear quick start guide with big, easy-to-follow pictures. Just a few tweaks needed here in my opinion. The machine is well protected and there's a large accessory box with tools, parts and the 4 tool heads. There is some assembly needed, but it's done in well under an hour. The main steps: attach the automatic filament feeders, spool holders, waste bin, PTFE guides, the tool heads themselves, and plug in the USB-C tool head cables. The manual doesn't tell you which screws go on the tool head side and which on the printer side. Trial and error solved it, but one screw thread on the frame was slightly off, a small issue that other beta testers have reported as well. And while the waste bin has a bit more play than I'd like, it stayed in place for over 100 hours of printing. Otherwise, setup is smooth and straightforward. Calibration is fully automated, except for one step, removing the build plate and cleaning each nozzle for nozzle offset calibration. The inductive sensor for this is on the bed, and judging from my print, the alignment is spot on. The one patience test: full bed leveling takes ages. This needs to be improved, also for regular printing. More on that later. After that, loading filament, slicing a first bench in Snapmaker's Orca slicer is quick and can be sent directly to the printer. That process worked well at the start, but as we see later, not always. Yet, a good looking benchy though, right out of the gate. But before printing more, let's take a closer look at the machine, the tech and its features. The U1 is a 270mm cubed, semi-enclosed CorrXY printer and a tool changer with 4 tool heads. Up front there's a glass door, at the rear a plastic window, and the sides use injection molded plastic panels. The look clearly takes cues from the Bamboo Lab rounded edge box design we see everywhere meanwhile. Build quality feels solid, though some panel molds could use refinement for perfect alignment. Snapmaker says they're already working on that. A full enclosure add-on is planned, and I also noticed a cavity temperature sensor in fluid, which lets you monitor the internal environment. Looking at the motion system, the lightweight carbon fiber rods and high acceleration design again remind us on Bamboo Lab's approach, with print speeds comparable to the X1 and P1 series. We'll compare that later. The tool head locking mechanism is a simplified, optimized take on the Prusa XL's design. Also, each tool head gets its own nozzle wiping station, something I wish was standard on all nozzle probing printers like this one. The tool head carrier uses a 3-ball alignment system with a slide to lock and magnetic hold, plus shaft positioning on the printer side. Unlike the XL, there's no manual calibration for tool head positions necessary, which also means less chance for user error. Yep, that happens easily. Been there. Tool changes in my testing were smooth, reliable and quick, about 5 seconds each. The carrier provides the part cooling fan, which only runs when a tool head is engaged, and there is an extra side-mounted auxiliary fan for additional part cooling. The tool head itself carries the rest: extruder, hot end fan, and filament sensor. It's a less integrated approach than Bontex Index, but a bit more efficient than the XL, which has separate part cooling for each tool head. The stuck filament profiles currently allow a max flow rate of around 13 mm³ per second for PETG and up to 20 for PLA matte. Not bad, but not extreme either. Under extrusion was never an issue in my tests. The hot end reaches 300 degrees Celsius and heats very quickly, even faster than the H2D and K2 Plus, with each hot end pulling a maximum of around 60 watts. The extruder gears are hardened steel, ready for abrasive filaments, but the stock 0.4 mm stainless steel nozzles aren't ideal for long-term carbon fiber use, for instance. Snapmaker says more hardened options will be available later this year. There's also automatic flow calibration, so no manual pressure advance tuning is needed. That feature works well, but right now it's slow. And I'm not sure if it stores settings separately for each toolhead already. If I run bed leveling plus flow calibration before a print, there's a really long wait before the first layer starts. The U1 offers a 270 mm³ build volume, so slightly larger than BambuLab's X1, P1 or A1 series, but far from a large format machine. The aluminum bed has embedded magnets to hold the double-sided PE-coated spring steel sheet, and it also houses the sensor for XY nozzle alignment calibration. The Z-axis uses a 3-smooth-rod setup driven by a single motor and belt. After finishing print testing, I noticed all bed carriers were loose. This might have affected layer stacking slightly, though print quality was decent overall, as we'll see. The bed is specified for a maximum of 100 degrees Celsius. My thermal camera measured a maximum of about 94 degrees Celsius on the surface after heat soak. Edges were 5 to 7 degrees Celsius cooler, not perfect but good enough for full bed prints. I've seen much bigger variations on other machines. Bed heat up times are impressively quick. Heater maximum power draw peaks at around 1000 watts. At the current firmware stage, bed probing is, as mentioned, very slow. Also, Clipper's adaptive bed meshing, which only probes the print area, isn't implemented yet. My bed mesh showed a range of less than 0.3 mm variation, which is just so acceptable for that size. A full first layer test print confirmed it compensates well, though the outer areas were a tad too close to the surface. No first layer issues though throughout my testing. Connectivity includes Wi-Fi, USB, an add-on port at the rear, and another connector in the toolhead parking area for exhaust fans of the upcoming full enclosure lid. There's also 8 GB of onboard storage. That's convenient and enough for plenty of time lapses and print files. Try and ask BambuLab how much they give you out of the box. The 3.5 inch touchscreen makes clear, Snapmaker needs to earn money with the U1 despite the low price tag. It's fixed into the body and therefore at a fixed angle. Resolution is a modest 480x320, yet the screen is responsive and the overall UI layout works, though some color contrasts should be improved, and I often wished for more obvious accept or confirm buttons instead of Xing my actions after done. Temperature control works a bit differently than most printers, but I got used to it. I also noticed slight tearing while scrolling. The integrated camera delivers 2K resolution, but the frame rate is very low, noticeably under 1 frame per second, quite similar to Bambu's budget P1 and A1 series. That's fine for time lapses, but in my opinion not ideal for live print monitoring. 5 to 10 FPS would be acceptable. The right side LEDs could be brighter, but it's adequate for checking prints on the slicer preview or app without extra lighting. One easy fix for Snapmaker, please have the lights turned on automatically at print start. The U1 supports spaghetti failure detection, though in my entire test period I never triggered it, so I can't confirm how well it works at this stage. The U1 runs on a modified version of Clipper, with a fluid front and accessible via browser. Since Clipper is open source, I'll check in the review whether Snapmaker fully complies with its license requirements. According to Snapmaker, their Clipper version will be open sourced on GitHub in due course. Snapmaker provides their custom Snapmaker Orca Slicer, a modified build of Orca Slicer. The original Orca Slicer should also work, though not all features may be supported right away. The so far provided print profiles are decent, but far from encompassing. ABS, other high temp materials, and coarse print settings are missing at current state. During my preview phase, connectivity of app and slicer integration was one of the biggest work in progress. I ran into many connection drops and failed print uploads. I rarely used the smartphone app because of connection issues. For wireless uploads, I simply used Fluid, that worked every time. Also, the TPU profile still needs tuning, especially for multi-material chips as we'll see later. One thing I like, the built-in RFID reader and RFID tagged filaments. The printer automatically detects material type and color, which saves time, at least for SnapMaker filaments. A quick word on the automated filament feeding feature, as I was very keen on that, since manual feeding into long Bowden tubes like on the XL is not very convenient. Once inserted into the feeder, it grabs the filament and pushes it near the toolhead, similar to Bambus AMS or Creality CFS. As soon as you start a print, it should load it into the nozzle. At current state, that works only at the success rate of around 50%. Workaround, push it through the heated hot end manually. Please, SnapMaker, get this fixed in time. Very important and useful feature here. Max specified speed for the U1 is 500 mm per second at 20,000 mm per second squared acceleration. What really counts are the set slicer speeds. And those match Bambus X1 and P1 series, making it faster than the Prusa XL. Combined with quicker tool changes, that's a real advantage, and you'll see it in the print tests. Since the U1 is semi-enclosed and lacks official ABS or high-temp profiles, I focused on PLA, PETG and TPU. We start with a classic, that 4-color Deadpool bust. Result on the U1? Details are nice, good overhangs, and fastest time I've seen for this multicolor print so far. But without the perch tower, oozing is visible at the rear, whereas the XL is perfect there without the perch tower. So anti-oozing tuning for the profiles on the U1 could help, or just use a perch tower. Next, another very cool model. Wexstr's T-Rex wall decoration came out nicely as well. Great detail, almost zero stringing on the finer teeth, and as expected, again faster than the XL at the same setup. Interestingly, Bambus Studio shows less waste for the P1S than for the H2D. Must be a calculation bug here in Bambus Studio. And the last colorful one. A print I wanted to do for ages now. This mini Gordon Freeman, again designed by Wexstr. Two parts and support heavy at 350% scale. A super cool one. I really like the outcome. Time to try some multi-material with a CT scan of a lower leg, aka foot. This one combines PLA for the bones, PETG for support interface layers for easy removal, and TPU for the flexible joints. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to succeed here, as the TPU toolhead kept clogging. I assume that can be solved with an improved anti-oozing strategy, as TPU printing in general works, as we'll see shortly. To get an impression of the general printing capabilities of the SnapMaker U1, I also did a range of single color prints and it performed well here. That challenging Voronoi deer printed from PETG, which I also tested on other printers lately, mostly tests retracting and stringing with PETG. It came out well for what it is from PETG, though we see fine stringing. Retract settings have potential for optimization. The belly is printed mid-air, so it's hard to get done nicely without supports. That part from my The 24/7 printed printer, printed from shiny black PETG, is mostly here to emphasize VFA and to check coarse layer performance. Ah yes, there it is, the belt pitch pattern. Though for anything else, I consider this a good print at 0.3mm layer height. Last but not least, a nasty TPU print I like to use in my testing, as it tests TPU printing performance mostly concerning retracting and stringing. Almost impossible to do this perfectly. Finishing this print is an achievement already. After the clocks I had on the multi-material print, I had doubt for success, but it finished. Not perfect concerning stringing, the Prusa XL excels here, but the result confirming the TPU profile works per se. Bottom line of the print tests, the SnapMaker U1 is a capable printer at modern speeds and a very fast tool changer. Maybe the fastest? More importantly, the printing was reliable. Except for that multi-material foot, there were zero fails for multicolor or single color. So let's have a brief look at noise. The U1 at current state is not a silent printer. Just like the Prusa XL, the motors produce a noticeable high-pitched whine during tool changes and travel moves. Noise levels ranged from about 55 and close to 65 dBA in my measurements. The four hot end fans aren't quiet either. I hope Snapmaker will swap them out for the final product. A slower, quieter mode for overnight prints would be also very welcome. On the plus side, when the machine is idle, there are no unnecessary electronics cooling fans running, unlike many other printers.
Hello, silence. That's the PC in my background.
Since the U1 prints multi-material chips much faster than multiplexers like the Bamboo P1S, but powers four separate tool heads, I wanted to check how energy use compares. For a quick reference for average power draw at PLA printing, not a deep dive, I ran a worst case test. 4 cubes, 4 colors, 4 tool changes every layer. The U1 drew about around 145 watts on average, compared to the P1S at 80 watts. That's expected with only one hot end on the P1S. The real difference shows with the Deadpool bust example. The P1S would take around 55 hours to complete the job, while the U1 would finish in just 11 hours, here with Perch Tower. That works out to about 1.6 kilowatt hours for the U1 versus 4.4 kilowatt hours for the P1S, and we haven't discussed perch waste yet. Result: 41 grams of waste for the perch tower on the U1 versus 823 grams on the P1S. Now factor in that the P1S AMS combo costs around the same as the U1 Kickstarter price, depending on Bamboo's actual discounts. The U1 is clearly ahead here in time, waste and energy savings. I mean, slicer predictions are good enough nowadays to do your own calculations for cost per year. And with that in mind, let's wrap this video up and talk about where the U1 already shines and where Snapmaker still has homework to do before shipping to backers in Q4 this year. As you know, many people skip straight to the conclusion, so here's the bottom line. This is a Kickstarter campaign. That means your money is essentially a bet on Snapmaker delivering what they promise. Snapmaker is not a startup, they are an established company. They could have gone the pre-order route, but they chose Kickstarter. That alone should make you ask, do you trust them enough to back now? From my testing of this late prototype, here's where we stand. The good news, I had plenty of nice prints, tool changes were fast and reliable, and the machine has the potential to replace a lot of wasteful, slow multiplexer setups at homes and in print farms. The homework? Fix the automated filament feeding, polish connectivity between slicer, app and printer, expand the filament and slicer profiles, and iron out the many smaller software flaws. You find the full list of issues I noted during my testing in the pinned comment below. These aren't deal breakers or even conceptual flaws, but in my eyes, they need to improve before shipping to customers. If Snapmaker gets these points from the current 80% state to 95% by the time Kickstarter backers receive their units, this will be the first affordable, fast, and convenient tool changer many of us, including me, have been dreaming about for years. Personally, I've only backed one Kickstarter hardware campaign up to date. Bamboo Labs X1 Carbon in 2022, after testing it. And I'm going to back this one as well, the Snapmaker U1, also after hands-on testing. That's not a recommendation or influencing, that's me putting my money where I see potential and on what excites me. Should you back it or wait? That's up to how much you trust Snapmaker and how much you like the idea of a machine that might change the multi-material game. Let me know in the comments, I'm genuinely curious. If this video helped you decide, consider using my link in the description to support the channel. And leave a like, subscribe, and share this with anyone who should know more about the U1. Servus and see you in the next one. Thank you, Shuno!